Welcome to Learning English, a daily 30-minute program from the Voice of America. I'm Ashley Thompson.
And I'm Mario Ritter Jr. This program is designed for English learners, so we speak a little slower and we use words and phrases especially written for people learning English. This is what you will hear on today's program. Anna Matteo reports on a geothermal energy deal. Next, Denmark's farm animal tax. Brian Lynn reports on Boeing's Starliner spacecraft. Then, the lesson of the day. But first, Guinness World Records recently recognized a 41-year-old Brazilian man for having the world's largest collection of soccer shirts. Cassio Brandão has collected 6,101 shirts since 2000. His collection includes rare Pelé jerseys and a 1998 World Cup shirt signed by Brazilian star Ronaldo. They are more than just 6,101 pieces of fabric. They are 6,101 stories that help us tell a bit of the history of soccer, Brandão told Reuters. Soccer is known as football in much of the world. Brandão keeps the shirts at Alambrado Soccer and Culture, a collector's club he founded in São Paulo. The club brings together 60 people who trade stories and jerseys. He wore white gloves as he showed the shirts to visitors. Brandão's collection includes the shirt worn by Pelé when the Brazilian player met Britain's Queen Elizabeth II in 1968. She was the guest of honor at a game played at Rio de Janeiro's Maracanã Stadium during an official visit to Brazil. Pelé is the star at Alambrado. The club is filled with Pelé's signed shirts and pictures. The Brazilian soccer player died in December 2022. Some shirts can go up to 40,000 reais, but a Pelé shirt is priceless, Brandão said. 40,000 reais are worth about $7,200. Brandão also displayed a 1994 Brazil jacket worn by seven-time Formula One world champion Lewis Hamilton at last year's São Paulo Grand Prix. The British driver, an honorary Brazilian citizen, borrowed the jacket to wear at the event. A large part of Brandão's collection is dedicated to his local club Corinthians. It includes jerseys from Ronaldo's time with the club and shirts worn by his favorite player, Socrates. Each shirt contains a story, Brandão said. Stories of wins, losses, and overcoming. I'm Mario Ritter Jr.
The method of making electricity from the Earth's natural heat has been moving forward quietly for many years. Recently, that effort has reached a milestone with a big new project. Southern California Edison announced it will buy electricity from Fervo Energy, a company based in Houston, Texas. Fervo uses geothermal energy to produce electric power. The company is going to drill up to 125 geothermal wells in the southwestern state of Utah, The goal is to produce 400 megawatts of electricity. That is being described as enough to supply power to 400,000 homes. Wilson Ricks is an energy systems researcher at Princeton University in New Jersey. He said if the business deal helps geothermal technology, it could be massively impactful for global decarbonization. The term decarbonization means using machines and methods that do not produce carbon-based substances when they are used. New geothermal companies are using the drilling technology that oil and gas industries developed. They drill down into areas where underground rock is very hot to create steam, which can be used for power production. Engineers have been working on this technology for many years. The United States is among the world's leaders in geothermal energy. But the U.S. Energy Information Administration, or EIA, says it accounts for less than half of 1% of the nation's electricity. Fervo is among the first companies to drill in what are called geothermal reservoirs. The EIA describes these areas as very hot rock that are fairly close to the surface of the Earth, between 1 and 3 kilometers. In 2021, the company signed an agreement with Google to drill 3 wells in Nevada. The Associated Press reported that the project began supplying power to the Nevada electricity system, or grid, in November. The new development in Utah is called the Cape Station Project. It is about 320 kilometers south of Salt Lake City. It is expected to begin providing electricity as early as 2026. California Energy Commission Chair David Hochschild said his state supports electricity that does not release carbon when it is produced. He said geothermal power works well with solar farms to provide steady electricity when the wind is not blowing or clouds block the sun. He believes this is important to ensure reliable energy as California cuts the use of oil, gas, and coal. Sarah Jewett is vice president of Fervo. She called the deal exciting. Jewett said the deal isn't a niche energy resource going to a niche use. The word niche describes something that has very limited availability and limited use in the real world. I'm Anna Matteo.
Denmark will tax farm animals, such as cattle and pigs, for releasing methane, a kind of greenhouse gas, starting in 2030. Some scientists think that greenhouse gases trap heat in the Earth's atmosphere, causing rising temperatures. The European country is the first in the world to agree to such measures targeting greenhouse gas emissions. Taxation Minister Jeppe Bruch said the aim is to reduce Danish greenhouse gas emissions by 70% from 1990 levels by 2030. Danish farmers will be taxed about $43 per ton of carbon dioxide equivalent in 2030. However, because of an income tax deduction of 60%, the actual cost per ton will start at $17.30 and increase to $43 by 2035. Carbon dioxide usually gets more attention for its part in climate change. But the U.S. National Oceanic and Atmospheric Administration says methane traps about 87 times more heat over a 20-year timescale under some conditions. Methane is emitted from landfills, oil and natural gas systems, and farm animals. Scientists say it has increased quickly since 2020. The United Nations Environment Program says 32% of human-caused methane comes from farm animals. Bruce said, "We will take a big step closer in becoming climate neutral in 2045. He added that Denmark will be the first country in the world to introduce a real CO2 tax on agriculture, and hoped other countries would follow. New Zealand passed a similar law that was to take effect in 2025. However, the legislation was recently removed after farmers criticized the measure. There was also a change of government following the 2023 election. New Zealand said it would not include agriculture in its emissions trading policy and would look for other ways to reduce methane. In Denmark, the center-right government reached the tax agreement after meeting with farmers, business representatives, labor organizations, and others. Denmark's move comes after months of protests by farmers across Europe against climate change measures. The rules, they say, could drive them out of business. The Danish Society for Nature Conservation, an environmental group, took part in the talks. It described the tax agreement as a historic compromise. Maria Rumert-Gerding, head of the organization, said, "We have succeeded in landing a compromise on a CO2 tax which lays the groundwork for a restructured food industry, also on the other side of 2030. An average cow in Denmark is believed to produce the equivalent of about 6 metric tons of CO2 yearly. The government of Denmark said that there were nearly 1.5 million cattle in the country in 2022. The Scandinavian country is a large dairy and pork exporter. Denmark also will tax pigs, although they produce far less emissions than cows. Denmark also will tax pigs, although they produce far less emissions than cattle. The tax is to be approved in the 179-seat parliament. The bill is expected to pass."
Two American astronauts have been delayed at the International Space Station, ISS, while engineers try to fix problems with Boeing's Starliner spacecraft. Starliner is a joint project between Boeing and the American space agency, NASA. The capsule arrived at the ISS on June 6th. It had launched a day earlier from Cape Canaveral in Florida. The trip was a test flight that marked the first time the Starliner spacecraft successfully carried astronauts to space. It transported NASA's Butch Wilmore and Sonny Williams to the ISS. The two were expected to remain in space for about 1 week. But problems affecting Starliner have already led Boeing and NASA officials to postpone the trip back to Earth several times. Reuters news agency reported one of its sources with knowledge of flight planning said NASA was targeting a return date of July 6th. Since its June 5th liftoff, Starliner has experienced at least 5 helium leaks. In addition, some of the capsule's thrusters have failed. NASA would like to use Starliner to support its future exploration activities on the Moon as part of its Artemis program. But Boeing has struggled to complete the testing process before it gets approval for repeated trips to the ISS. NASA wants more time to examine problems with Starliner's propulsion system. This system is attached to the capsule but is not designed to return to Earth for inspection. Instead, it is released during re-entry and burns up in the atmosphere. Steve Stitch is NASA's Commercial Crew Program Manager. He explained the return delay during a news conference last week. Stitch said, "We're just taking a little more extra time to review all the data and also learn as much as we can while we have this service module in orbit." Starliner's propulsion system is part of what NASA describes as the spacecraft's service module. The space agency also noted that it did not want the return flight to conflict with spacewalks. A spacewalk was called off this week after water leaked from an astronaut's spacesuit. At least one other spacewalk is planned. 5 of the capsule's 28 thrusters failed after Starliner arrived at the ISS. NASA said all but one thruster restarted, and they were found to be working during a later test firing. Officials suspect heat from increased thruster use on arrival at the ISS caused the problem. Boeing said the one problematic thruster had been turned off and would not be an issue for the return trip. The capsule launched with one small helium leak, and 4 more were discovered by the time it reached the ISS. Helium is used to pressurize fuel for the thrusters. A rubber seal was suspected of failing, causing the problem. Boeing and NASA say they will continue to consider landing dates once the spacewalks are completed. Boeing has said the capsule can remain at the space station for 45 days or longer if needed. Mission leaders plan to keep examining the thruster problem and helium leaks. With their extended stay, Wilmore and Williams have been helping with chores and research at the Orbiting Space Laboratory. NASA has said there is no rush for the astronauts to leave, and there are enough supplies to support their stay. During his comments to reporters last week, NASA's Stitch stated the agency's desire to safely return the astronauts as soon as possible. So far, we don't see any scenario where Starliner is not going to be able to bring Butch and Sonny home, he said. I'm Brian Lynn.
And now, the lesson of the day.
Hello, my name is Anna Matteo.
My name is Andrew Smith.
And I'm Jill Robbins.
You're listening to The Lesson of the Day on the Learning English Podcast. Today's lesson helps you do more with Level 2 of our video series, Let's Learn English. This series shows Anna Matteo in her work and life in Washington, D.C.
Today's lesson explains how we relate or connect two events in the past that happened at different times.
In Lesson 3 of Level 2, Anna and her new work partner, Pete, talk about why they did not arrive at a meeting on time.
But they disagree about the reasons they were late. Let's listen first to what Anna says.
You two are late. Exactly 43 minutes late. What happened?
He had to get his special coffee. Special coffee!
She had to feed her birds. Her birds?
Of course I have to feed the birds. Who's going to feed
them? It's very special coffee.
Okay.
You don't have any
okay.
good taste.
Okay. I can see already that you two need my help. You can't both talk at the same time. You have to take turns. All right, Anna, you go first.
Sure. Kelly, see, Pete and I live in the same building, so we decided to meet at 8 a.m. 8 a.m. to come to work together. I had waited 15 minutes when Pete arrived. After Pete had wasted time waiting for coffee, we were late. I left you a message.
Anna explains that they were late after Pete had wasted, or spent too much time, getting his special coffee.
Notice that there are two events in the past here. They were late, but before they were late, Pete had gotten some coffee.
When one event in the past happens before another event, we can use the past perfect tense to make this clear. We use the auxiliary verb had plus the past participle to show what happened first.
That's why Anna said Pete had wasted time. The auxiliary had tells us that Pete wasted time before they were late.
Now let's listen to Pete's explanation of why they were late. And listen for when he uses the past perfect tense.
Yeah. That's not why we're late. This is why we're late. I had arrived
on time at 8 a.m., but didn't see Anna. She was standing behind a tree. I think she was hugging it. I always walk to work, but she said that would take too long and that a scooter would be faster. It was awful. I hated it. And it added too much time to our commute. Then Anna stopped by a pond to feed the birds. She had named them after characters from books and yelled the names out loud. Romeo, Juliet, Sherlock.
By the time she had fed all the birds, we were late.
Did you hear Pete use the past perfect? Listen again to this sentence.
I had arrived
on time at 8 a.m., but didn't see Anna.
Now think, what happened first? Pete's arrival or Pete's not seeing Anna? That's right. First, he arrived at 8 a.m., and then he didn't see Anna. Here's one more example from Pete.
By the time she had fed all the birds, we were late.
We often use adverbs with the past perfect to help show how the two events relate to each other in the past. In this example, Pete uses the adverb phrase by the time, which means when an action has been completed or finished.
Other adverbs commonly used with the past perfect are the adverbs already and never. For example, we might say,
I had already seen that movie, so I didn't go with my friends when they went to see it. I had never given a speech before, so I felt nervous.
Jill, those are good examples, but what about those times when we say, had? That might sound a little strange or perhaps surprising to some of our listeners.
That's true, but if the main verb is have, the past participle of have is had. And because we use the auxiliary had, that gives us the two words had. Of course, it's easier to understand if you hear it in a sentence, like this one.
Because I had such a hard time learning, my professor didn't think I should continue with that subject.
We should also tell our listeners that when they watch Lesson 3 of Level 2, they can see and hear Professor Bott explain more about the past perfect. But now let's listen to the person Anna and Pete meet and see what she thinks about their disagreements.
This is what I think. You two see the same event very differently. Does this happen often with you two?
Yes.
No. Yes.
No. What are you talking about?
Okay, this is good. It's good to see things differently. I have an idea. We will call the show He Said, She Said. For every story, you tell a different point of view.
That is a great idea, Kelly. Pete, we are different. That's why I thought of you for this job.
I think you two understand perfectly.
Let's get to work.
Having more than one point of view, or way of thinking about things, can be very useful for a team that is working on a project.
That's true. However, if you have too many points of view, that can also be a problem.
True. We have an idiomatic expression that relates to that. We say, too many cooks spoil the broth. Broth is another word for the liquid in soup. The expression, too many cooks spoil the broth, means if you have too many people trying to be in charge or in control, it's difficult to get the job done.
Well, luckily for our podcast, we normally just have two cooks, so I think it works out pretty well.
I hope our listeners agree. Listeners, we'd like to hear from you. Have you ever worked with someone who is very different from you? Write about it to us at learningenglish@voanews.com. And remember that each lesson of Let's Learn English comes with a lesson plan you can download for free. It has lots of activities you can use to practice English.
And don't forget that you can also find us on Facebook, YouTube, and Instagram. And be sure to share the lesson of the day and other programs from Learning English with your friends and family. And thank you for listening. I'm Andrew Smith.
And I'm Jill Robbins.
And that's our program for today. Join us again tomorrow to keep learning English through stories from around the world. I'm Ashley Thompson.
And I'm Mario Ritter Jr.